Uwe Terrigan for his tireless efforts, making sure that this day was a success. And a special thank you as well to the Herculean support of Sherry Hammer, who did just a remarkable job making sure that I was going to be able to do that. So again, thank you all for coming. Our final speaker of the day, to close things out, is someone who's very familiar to our community, to our shul, to the Jewish community in general, the Rebbe of many of us, of many more of our children, grandchildren. And it just gives me gives us a great pleasure to welcome Maureen Rabbeinu and Rav Schachter to discuss that.
Thank you very much. Yeshus Maranam and Rabbanam. The Prima Godin was a Malamed of young children. And he writes in his Igeris, he has two letters that he wrote to a Malamed how to teach. So he writes in the first Igeris that he uses a special Tanakh that has the three letters of the Shoresh printed in hollow. The rest of the letters are printed in bold. And the Shoresh, so when you look in the Chodesh, right down there, so the Dalet Beis Resh is hollow, so you see right away what the Shoresh is. I don't know why they don't print it anymore like that, but we should insist with the publishers that they should start printing such a Tanakh again, such a Chodesh again, so make it easier for the children to figure out what the Shoresh is. They had the days of the people got it. Over 100 years ago, there was a Malamed who also published a sefer about the tips on being successful in the Chinuch. So he writes that when he teaches Chumash to young children, he doesn't feel it necessary to tell over all of the Torah Shebaal Peh in connection with every pasuk of the Chinuch. Don't stop. You just have to give Pshut Lashon Nivra. When you're teaching young children, when you're learning Chumash for the first time, so he gives an example that when he teaches the Parsha of Korban Chatos, he doesn't think that it's necessary to say when you have to. The Torah says if you do an Aver B'Shogeg, you have to bring on Korban Chatos. What if a person cheated in business B'Shogeg? What if he said Lashon Hara B'Shogeg? He probably said it in Bezik. He probably cheated in business in Bezik. But what if they read it? What if he did the Aver B'Shogeg? So there's no Chatos. The Chatos is only the person violated an Aver B'Shogeg, which if he would have violated the Bezik, it would have been Koros. So the culture is not a Koros, he should do us the Chatos. He writes in the Sefer. He doesn't think that it's necessary to bring this out when you're teaching young children Chumash to just learning for the first time Chumash. That's the whole heavy tradition of the Torah Shebaal Peh. So Rav Chaim Soloveitchik sent him a letter, which was available now in print. He said he thinks that he's absolutely wrong. That's Mamish Pshut Lashon Nivra. The Torah Shebaal Peh tells you what the Pashuk Pshat and the Pasuk is. You're going to tell the children, you're going to teach the children that whenever a person does an Aver B'Shogeg, he brings a Chatos, you're misleading them. That's part of Pshut Lashon Nivra. You don't have to say over all the Rashi's, not necessarily over all of the Torah Shebaal Peh, but there's certain aspects of the Torah Shebaal Peh that are so fundamental and so basic that if you don't say that over, it's as if you're teaching the wrong pshat in the pasuk. I remember when my children, we lived right across the street from Broyer, so they just rolled out of bed and went to Broyer's Yeshivat. So I was reviewing with my children for an exam. So I asked one of them, I remember what his son or daughter was. So I asked them, they were learning Parshas Mishpatim. So I said, what's the din of kofar? So they didn't know what I was talking about. So I said, you don't know kofar? So I told them what the din. Oh yeah, they know that din. Then I said, what's the din of shloshim shalala? Didn't know what I was talking about. Then I said, what is? Oh yeah, that they know what it is. I think it's not right. Like Rabbi Soloveitchik used to say, you have to give the baby a name. You have to tell what the name of the Parsha is. So the Torah Shebaal Peh has expressions, has terminology. We should use as much the Melamdim, the Mechanchim, for young children to use as much as possible of the expressions of the Torah Shebaal Peh, so that the children will know what to call this part. That this is a Parsha of Kofar, this is a Parsha of Shloshim Shalevet, this is Idis, this is Mefata, this is Kamlev Derabim. You have to tell them all the details of Kamlev Derabim. Tell them, this is the Parsha of Kamlev Derabim. I think that's very important. When we learn the Parshas and Chumash about Karbanos, it's like a big jungle, and we don't know, we don't understand whether you're coming or going. You have to show the children. The Karbanos are divided into two categories, the Kachin Kachin and Kachin Kachin. If you read the Pesukim, everything is explicit. And the Kachin Kachin have to be shechted Betzafen, it says so. The other Karbanos don't have to be Betzafen. This is Poshim Shechted in the Pasuk. When I was a little boy, they were teaching me Chumash Vayikra, they never explained this to me. They never show the words. If you tell the children these things, the words will jump out from the chumash. They'll realize they'll be able to identify in half a minute whether any given carbon is a kachim kachim or a kachim kalim, and so on. And to show there's man machil and makam achil and who eats the carbon is dependent whether it's a kachim kachim or a kachim kalim. It's all explicit in the chumash. Did the kohanim even go to the bayim even? But if the baby doesn't point it out, the children are not going to notice this. They'll just see a million and one details, a whole jungle of details of halachas. They won't see any system. They won't see any mahalach. This is very important, I think. I remember one of my children was studying for an exam, Chodesh, in elementary school, and the teacher had taught them, Anaira Habaras is a girl who was engaged. I said, engaged? What are you talking about? Engaged girl. There's Eris and there's Nisun. The words are in the Chodesh. You have to teach the children what's Eris and what's Nisun. You know, they shouldn't have to wait till learning Chasmicha and the learning Sundas and Yeshiva to know that there's a difference between Eris and Nisun. Little children attend weddings, so we should tell them. The first half of the wedding ceremony is Erisin, and after meeting Ksuba, the second half of the ceremony is the Nisun. We should show them here, it says it in the Chumash, but there's a difference between Erisin and Nisun. I think it's not right when you teach Chumash, they just go Pasuk Aleph, Pasuk Beis, Pasuk Gimel, Pasuk Dal. Sometimes you have to show how the Pesukim, you have to show the way the Parshas are interconnected. You have to show the children that there are three Parshas that deal with the Dinim of Yom Tov. Maybe in the first year when they learn Chumash, that's already 2 months. They have to go Pasuk Aleph, they have to go in the way. But if they're a little older, you have to show them that you have Parshas Amorim and Parshas Amorim. Then you have the Parshas Binchas, then you have the Parshas Re'eh. And the Parshas Amorim, the main emphasis of that is the Malachim. Parshas Binchas, the emphasis is really about the Musafim. And Parshas Re'eh, about all the Chavis Hayam, all the special korbanos. Younger children are not prepared. They may not even have a whole Chumash with the Hamishim from Shedrach. They may only be using the Chumash Hayikra. They have the whole Hamishim from Shedrach. But the children are a little older and they're learning Chumash. So the Malami, the Rebbe, should show them the way the Parshas fit together. Show the mitzvot tzitzis appears two places in Chumash. Show the differences. The mitzvot spheres appears two places in Chumash. And show not to give heavy Torah, just to show that the mitzvah appears in more than one place. And to tie together the loose threads, the loose strings. Very often, we teach when they teach Chumash to young children, so they obviously allow to get teach Chumash and Rashi. Rashi often quotes midrashim, drushes of the Torah about that. Many of the drushes are not to teach the Shalmikram. That's what the Rashbam writes, the famous comment the Rashbam writes, that he told his grandfather that Rashbam used to learn with Rashi, because he's grandson of Rashi. So he said that his whole pirush is all drushes of the Torah Shabbat, where Rashi often does write the Shalmikram. So Rashi admitted to him, if I would have, he was a very old man, he said he admitted, if he would have a couple of years left the Torah to do the work, he would write another pirush of Chumash, a pirush of Pshut HaShalmikram. I think we always have to give Pshut HaShalmikram, then explain that Ein HaMikri Yetzimidei Pshuto, the Rambam writes in the Sefer HaMitzvahs, the Chazal never said Ein HaMikri Elo Pshuto. They never said the only thing that's true is Pshut HaShalmikram. The Gemara tells a story in Masech HaShabbos, that one of the Chachamim was learning for some of the years, I think he was learning for 18 years in Yeshiva. He never knew that Pshut HaShalmikram is binding. Until one fine day, the Rebbe said, Ein HaMikri Yetzimidei Pshuto, the Pshut HaShalmikram is also ours. Rushes of the Torah Shabbat are certainly ends, but the Pshut HaShalmikram is also ends. We have to explain, whenever you have a Rashi is putting a rush of the Torah Shabbat, you have to say this is an additional level of interpretation. After Rabbah dictated the Chumash to Moshe Rabbeinu word for word and letter for letter, that's our tradition. The Gemara learns that even from the fact that the same word is sometimes spelled Mole, sometimes spelled Chaser. So how do you have a right to Darshan if Moshe Rabbeinu made up his mind what to make? Since Moshe Rabbeinu didn't make up his mind, Baruch Shalom dictated the Chumash word for word, letter for letter. That's why we learn out halacha sometimes from the fact that the word is written mole, that the word is written chaser, yesterday said, v'iza ha-tohar al-atomi. V'iza ha-tohar al-atomi. So the Gemara has a drush of the fact that the word tohar is spelled tesei resh. Normally in Hebrew we would spell it tesei vavresh, because it's spelled tesei resh. The Gemara says, against its duke. Tzdukim during the Vaisheni, the Tzdukim claim that the one who does the Avodah by the Paradum has to be Mu'ur of Shemesh. He can't be a Tulyom. If he just went to Mikveh that day, didn't yet have Shemesh, he's not a full Torah. So the Chachamim said they're wrong. He's a Torah, he's a Torah Kodil. We have this thing called Torah Kodil, because the word Torah says Al Chasi. You have many brushes like that in the Gemara. The Gemara Ksuga says the word Naira, very often in biblical Hebrew, is spelled Nunai Resh. And once in a long while, it's spelled Nunai Resh. So the Gemara establishes Din based on the fact that it's spelled sometimes Mole, sometimes Chasi. Akhtaga sometimes included in the Din of Anar, sometimes not included. Whenever it's spelled Nunai Resh, so Akhtaga is an incomplete Naira. She's too young to be a Naira. And when it's spelled Nunai Resh, it means that she's a full Naira. So our tradition has it. We believe the Chumash was dictated to Moshe Rabbeinu word for word, letter for letter. And that's why sometimes we write halachas, we establish halachas based on the fact that a word is spelled in an awkward way, either Mole or Chaser. But we have Pshuta Sham Nikra, and I'm here to the name Pshuta. And in addition to the Pshuta Sham Nikra, the Baruch Hu dictated the Chumash to Moshe Rabbeinu in such a way that there is an additional level of interpretation. So very often, Rashi will give you the additional level of interpretation. Just there, Dugma, Moshel, Rashi and the Pasuk in Parshas Mishpatim comments when a person purchases an Amohet Riyah, so the Pasuk says, Lo Seitzik Kitzei Sa'alot. So Rashi quotes a drasha from the Torah Shema Peh, such a famous drasha, because Rashi quoted it. She doesn't have the Yitzhiya of Shem B'yak. Only an Eber Knani goes out of Shem B'yak. An Amohet Riyah doesn't go out. So both Ebenibri and Amnibri don't go out to Shem B'yam. That's not true to Shem B'yam. But let's say it say something. She doesn't have it, you see it. Like an Eben Kenaini, it doesn't say in the Pasuk. So the tour gives you the true to Shem B'yam, the Pirush HaTor. He says, if you have a girl working for you, Amnibri, she's a young girl. She's going to reach the age of 12, she's going to go free. She's only 10 years old, 11 years old. So you shouldn't send it to this tour to go shop. You shouldn't send it to the post office to pick up a package. Lo yiseitzik kitzei sa'alot. That's not the acheretz for a young little girl. She should wash the dishes in the house. She should do the laundry in the house. She should clean the windows, whatever. She should die for the baby. Do some work in the house. But you can't send her outside. Lo yiseitzik kitzei sa'alot. So that the Torah says that's shutur shamim. And Rav Rashi quotes from the Gemara, that's an additional level of interpretation. So I think this is important. We shouldn't mislead the children into believing that everything that Rashi says in Shulchan Shalmik, but certainly not so. You should be rogel on the Rebbe's Loshen, rogel on the Loshen of the Talmidim. That the Shulchan Shalmik certainly happens to happen on Shulchan Shalmik. And then there's an additional level of interpretation that the Torah Shabbat gives. There are secular books written by non-Jews, where the author had more than one Kavanah, had one obvious Kavanah. Then he had a hidden Kavanah, and they're reading books and poems, we have two hidden Kavanahs. It's not so far-fetched that the Rebbe Shalom, the Chumash to Moshe Rabbeinu had one obvious kavanah, Pshutu Shal Mikra, and then he had more than one hidden kavanah. Gemara says the one and only pasuk, the Mikra is written with the Pshutu Shal Mikra. It's not that, it says the pasuk, Ohayah Hapkar Rashi Taylor. How come when I was learning Chumash, they didn't tell me that? How come it took me many years till I learned Gemara? The Malamed in school should have told us that pasuk, there is no Pshutu Shal Mikra. Chashetel, you don't have the baby after the one who died. That's not what it means at all. Each phrase in the pasuk is a reference to a din of the Torah Shabbat. There is no pshutu shamikra, but you have a psukim. There is a pshutu shamikra, and then you have an additional level of interpretation of the drushes of the Torah Shabbat. Very often, my children were studying for exams. Broy is a wonderful school. I have no time to say, all my children went to Broy. I'm giving Michelle from Broy school. So when the children went to Broy, they said, Malam, then the Pichden, Rashi Pshat, and the Rashman Pshat, and the Rachayim Pshat, and the Kliyopis Pshat. They have to have four Pshatim, even if they're in high school, right? They have to have four Pshatim on any one given Pasuk. Is that really necessary? And the Pshat that's quoted in the Shulchan Aruch, the Rebbe would not teach. That's the most important. The Pshat that's accepted, Mahalocha Lamaisi, you know, what is the din based on this book? That the Rebbe didn't teach. He only taught all the fancy, fluffy interpretations. I don't think it's so important to give so many levels of interpretation in every pasuk. The children will be older, the boys and the girls will be older, and they'll have a big cross kedusha, so they'll look at all the mefarshim. They don't want to, but in elementary school or high school, I don't think that's so important. Important is to give what's accepted halacha l'maaseh. What is the pshat in the pasuk that's accepted halacha l'maaseh? And to show what's pshut to shom nikra, what's in Russia, the Torah Shabbat Pesach, Friday. To give five pshatim in any given pasuk. I remember when my father-in-law passed away, some of you remember him, he was a Rebbe in Torah Dass. Sefer on Kiddushin in the Makna, the Gemara has a famous comment based on the Pasuk in Novi that since the Chinuch Yishko does the Torah of Bakshin Yidil, Kimalach Hashem Tzavakasu. So the Gemara has a comment, Torah of Bakshin Yidil, we should learn Torah by this Rebbe, because the Rebbe is not the Malach Hashem Tzavakasu. If the Rebbe is not the Malach, then you shouldn't learn by that Rebbe. So what do you mean the Rebbe is not the Malach? How do you know what a Malach is like? So Rabbi Yifter, the Kaka once said, the Derech HaLot said, that the Rebbe shouldn't be so friendly with the Talmidim. No, we don't know what a Malach is like, so the Talmidim shouldn't know too much about the Rebbe's private life. If the Talmidim know too much about the Rebbe's private life, so he won't have a Yerushal covered for the Rebbe. That is his suggestion, Derech HaLot. So what does it mean if a Rebbe don't have Malach Hashem? So the Bosh of Shad is, the Rebbe seems to be a holy tzaddik. If he doesn't seem to be such an adaptive convinces, he shouldn't learn by that Rebbe. That's the Bosh of Shad. Rabban mentioned that the Aflor writes in the Sefer HaKedushin that the Pasuk refers to Nasat Elcha, Mahalchim, Beitachon Dimoy, but the Malachim are referred to as Omni. Malachim don't grow, they don't keep on advancing in greatness. Human beings are Mahalchim. A person is either advancing or regressing, he doesn't stay in the same Madrega. And Malachim always say, whatever Madrega the Rosham created, then that's what it is. So the Rapam applied that and explained what the Aflor says. This is a big problem in all issues. The Rebbe taught this Gemara. Let's say they're teaching Baba Kama an issue. So the Rebbe already taught Baba Kama last year, or 5 years ago, 10 years ago. So the Rebbe is advancing. He wants to learn one of our Shem. He wants to learn all the Shem Kobes. He wants to learn all the Nakhla's Dabi. He wants to learn all of the Yeshivat. The Rebbe wants to learn. But what is he going to teach to the students? The students are just looking at the Gemara for the first time. It's not the 10th time that they're looking at the Gemara. So the Rebbe is going to be like a human being who keeps on advancing. There are some Rebbe before they open up the Gemara, so they say what Rabbi Chaim says on the Gemara. The children don't know what it says in the Mishnah yet. They don't know what it says in the Gemara. What are you telling them about Rabbi Chaim? Teach them what it says. So Rabbi Pam was praising my father, was an Ola Racha. When he taught Gemara, he was like a Malach. He was Oymed. As if he hadn't advanced. My father will learn Rabbi Shimon. He would tell me the Torah from Rabbi Shimon Shkab also. But first he said, oh, what it says in the Mishnah. Then he said, oh, what it says in the Gemara. Then he said, oh, Rashi. So you have to start from scratch. You have to start from nothing. It's not that the Rebbe should be advancing and advancing. And Yeshiva, I remember years ago, used to be disputes among the Rabbein at meetings of the Rabbein, where the Yeshivas for Talmidim and Yeshivas for Rabbein. Some of the Rabbeim had the attitude of Yeshivas for the Rabbeim, that we should hold the learning. So we choose which Masechta to learn, which Perek to learn, and know that we should advance. It's not for the good, not for the well, for the Talmud. I think that's awful. Yeshivas for Talmud, what kind of machlokes was that? The Yeshivas for Rabbeim, Yeshivas for Talmud, and Yeshiva this year, we had always. We had a committee who chooses which Masechta to learn. And then the committee decided which Perek to learn based on what the Rabbeim wanted to learn. It wasn't based on the Torah HaTalmidim. Torah HaTalmidim, you have to pick what's more important for the Talmidim. You don't pick what's more important for the Rabbi. I never learned Krisis. I want to learn Krisis? What do you mean? The students are missing a lot of things before they get to Krisis. If you learn Baba Kama, so learn that part of Baba Kama that's more relevant to Halacha Lemaisa than the other parts. You don't learn the more omniscient part because you want it to be. A Rebbe is supposed to be like a Malach, that should be an Oymed, it shouldn't be a Malach, it shouldn't. The Rebbe wants to advance, and he wants to give a higher level of Shi'ar every year something higher. But it's not the Tervis of Talmidim. The Shi'ar have to be the Tervis of Talmidim. When the students, the same students who learn Chumash, like us, learn Tanakh, learn Dinim, so they learn computers in the afternoon, in secular studies. They're not 2 years source in the computers. There's no machlokes in the computers. There's one mahalach that works all over the world. It works in Ukraine, it works in South America, it works in Canada. All over the world, the computers work the same. We shouldn't emphasize so much. Some of the Rebbe and Yeshiva hack so much at that. The Yersois and the Mishnah, and the Ritva says this, and the Rashba says that, and the Mubiyesa says that. The young children will not be in a kailo. So they'll spend time learning all the Ritvas and all the Rashba. Young students, what are you hacking them? It's more important to cover more ground. They should have a heck if they should know more data. It's not so important to keep on analyzing and analyzing who you're talking to, who you're analyzing with. Young students in high school, even in college, they're not ready for all of this. You have to teach what it says in the Gemara. Years ago, there was a Chinuch who published Sefer HaTorah, the Hakotel. He was a very popular Chinuch. He had Sosach. Then he published an essay many years ago that's entitled "Achem Shechaton Chinuch Chinuch Abayim." So he says the students learning the yeshivas all are so mitigad ma, and they don't know what they should know because the rabbis are not teaching right. You have to teach. You have to go benakal or akav. First, you have to teach Chulish. Then you have to teach Lishanah Mishnayis. Then you have to teach Gemara. That's how it says in the Mishnah Pirkei Avos. Ben Chamish Mikra, that's in the Mishnah, Ben Chamish Esvei the Talmud. And all the yeshivas, they give in to the parents. The parents want to be able to brag to the other parents. My five-year-old child is already learning Gemara with the Marshal. It's not the Tavis, your child is not the Tavis, the yeshiva is not the Tavis, the other children. But because the parents bet they're going to take the child out and put him in a different school unless the Manah listens to them. So they came in, they're afraid they're not listening. So they keep on teaching Gemara at a younger age and younger age. How do you understand Gemara? It's not right. It's not right at all. People don't know. What does it mean to learn Torah? Let's say a boy learns in yeshiva until he gets married. What does it mean? What's the importance? What's the significance of learning Torah? So a lot of people think the significance of learning Torah is to sharpen your mind. That's why the Rabban Shalom told us to learn Torah to sharpen our mind. I don't think that's correct. That's the icing on top of the cake, is the sharpening of mind. The main thing of learning Torah says in Chumash, Ulamadatem osom, ushmartem la'as osom. You should learn all of the 613 mitzvahs. Ulamadatem osom, ushmartem la'as osom. You will know how to observe the mitzvahs. When you look at the Rambam, so the Rambam wrote, by way of introduction to his Mishnah Torah, to the Al-Hazoket, the Rambam wrote this Sefer HaMitzvot. It was written in Arabic, but he used the Hebrew translation. And the Mishnah Torah was written in Hebrew. A beautiful story, but the Sefer HaMitzvahs was written, was intended to be the introduction to the Mishnah Torah. Then in every section of the Mishnah Torah, he says, how many mitzvahs we're going to cover here? This section we're going to cover 15 mitzvahs, 10 mitzvahs less, and 5 mitzvahs less. This section we're going to have 5 mitzvahs, 4 mitzvahs less, and 1 mitzvahs less. And then by the time you get to the end of the whole Mishnah Torah, now you have covered all of the 613 mitzvahs. People lost track of what learning is all about. Learning means you have to know which are the 613 mitzvahs and what are all of the details of the 613 mitzvahs. Not so much to sharpen your mind. After you know all the details, you should try to put everything together in a neat package, and then you have to try to figure out an aleph. It looks like a jungle. You have a million trees in the forest, so you can't figure out any system over here. So that's a derech of learning, to be able to tie together the loose strings, to figure out an aleph, to see how everything holds together. But the main thing is not so much to teach one thing and to analyze it forever. In yeshiva this year, there's some rabbein who learned only 3.5 blocks all year. There's a big interview. What are you, crazy? I can't understand. How did the students go for that? They fooled the students into believing that that's called learning. 3.5 blocks all year. And what are they going to remember? They're not going to remember all the book for them that they registered. They're not going to remember the Gemara. I've had the students because they want to join the college. Otherwise, it's not my business to go see what the other rabbis are doing. So I ask the student, what did you learn? Tell me you learned 3.5 out of all year. And start asking him questions. He doesn't remember anything. How can you not remember? I don't know what his rabbi said. I ask him what it says in the Gemara. He doesn't remember the Gemara. So what did he learn a whole year? This is terrible. The fear of learning Gemara. You have to have a whole system. You have to know that there are 613 pictures. So learning means to learn Mishnais and learn all the dinim, learn all of the details. I remember when I was the Talmud in Yeshiva. So Rabbi Gerelich Shia, Rabbi Gerelich was a very entertaining rabbi, so a very colorful rabbi. So when a student would ask a question, in the middle of the Shia, students would ask a kasha. So sometimes students would ask a question, well, what's the din in this case? If he asked, what's the din? He always used to say, Ruf up the Abba Zarabba. Call the Abba Zarabba. Have a shot of what the din is called. That's not part of the Shia. Shia was only to analyze it. So this was the European shtick. And the Mir Yeshiva in Europe, and all the yeshivas in Europe, they didn't learn Lasuvish Maiz Aliva Dilchasa. And that's when the Chazanish was so upset about. The Chazanish was successful in reversing the trend to a certain extent. They emphasized a little more. The more considers learning Lasuvish Maiz Aliva Dilchasa, the highest level of learning. But if you learn the whole Gemara, you're supposed to be able to say, what is the din? You learn the whole Dach Gemara. Now, Lacha Maiz, what is the din? So the way they teach in Yeshivas now, they give such the full of such. The Rashba says this, and the Ramban says that, and this Gerson, and that Gerson, and the other Gerson. Enough, you don't know what the din is. It would be helpful if they would leave out a lot of Rashbos and a lot of Rambas and just say, there's different Pshatim anymore. The Pshat that's accepted in Shulchan Aruch is X, Y, Z. What's so difficult? End off. Lasuk Yishmaitz on the Hilchasim. You have to insist that in the Yeshivas they should do this. I was fortunate when I was a little boy, I was learning. My family lived in Pennsylvania. My parents had sent me to New York in order to go to the yeshiva because it wasn't the yeshiva at that time in Philadelphia. So the rabbeim that I had were refugees who came from Europe after the war. I had Rabbi Yankelevich, who should live for many years. He was my rabbi who taught us all the Gemara. He knew all the Gemaras. I had rabbeim who taught us Chumash. The rabbeim who taught us Chumash, they knew all the Gemaras. And when they were teaching Chumash, they knew what everything said. A lot of times the rabbis and the yeshivas are young, and there's only 10 lessons ahead of the students. That's a disaster. You can't have a rabbi who's only 10 lessons ahead of the students. The Gemara of Salvation once gave an interpretation of the Gemara. The Gemara says something about the Mahabad and Akkadish and Benachol. If a person says Havdalah, so if a person will be didactic and Havdalah, then he will be successful in learning. What's the connection between Havdalah and successful in learning? So they once gave the drasha, it's not the push of Shantimar. Many have the custom, I don't have the custom, many have the custom, when you do Havdalah, so you fill up the cup until it overflows. Simon Bracha, it's based on the Gemara. It's a simple, any humble wine doesn't spill. And so Shabbos, you don't have a Simon Bracha from the beginning of the week. My money says say Simon Shlom. But the Gemara says a Simon Bracha. Okay. So Rav Soloveitchik said, if you overflow, the Rebbe has to have so much learning when he's teaching to the Talmidim, it just overflowing from him. If the Rebbe's only going to be 5-10 lessons ahead of the Talmidim, he won't be successful. He has to have so much knowledge. I was fortunate. I had my Rabbein when I was a little boy. My Rabbein had learned in Europe before the war. They learned all the Gemara. They knew 1,000 times more than we knew. And they were teaching Gemara, they were then teaching Chumash, and they taught Mishnayos. They knew what to say, they knew what not to say. I think we have to work with the different yeshivas, that they should teach Chumash properly, they should teach Siddur. The reason why we don't teach Siddur is because we know that we know the rabbis know that they don't know Siddur. We teach the Gemara because we think we know the Gemara. We don't know how to teach it. We don't know the Gemara either. It's not so smart. But we should work out and we should teach Siddur. A lot of the children are not going to become big Talmid Chacham. They're not going to keep on learning for the rest of their lives. They're going to daven every day. One of the rabbis visited Kovner after the death of Rabbi Yitzchak Hunt, and he saw that Nachadorim, the Malamim, was teaching Siddur. He said, what's that all about? Is it because most of them are not going to go on to learn? Very few are going to continue to learn until everybody learned till Bar Mitzvah, then they got a job. And very few, one or two boys in every village, would go to learn in Yeshiva until they got married. So they had another siddur. So he assumed, this Rav who wrote this and said, yes, it must have been introduced by Rabbi Yitzchak Hanan himself. This was his chacham. He had to teach siddur. Maimonides and Rav Soloveitchik, Yeshiva and Boston, they used to have a class for the high school students, but they taught siddur. We should talk and teach Siddur. The children should know how to deal with it. What are the different parts of the Siddur, what everything represents. You have to teach Chumash properly. You have to teach Halacha usually is taught properly. Halacha is the only thing. But we don't teach enough Halacha. We don't teach enough Halacha. And Gemara should be taught properly. Instead of covering 3.5 lakh with all the Gesuris and all of the Svaris and all of the Rishonim, and everything's going to be forgotten, we have to cover more ground. We have to show shlit the etar shalayim shalom yisicha the tevel shalahem. When they study mathematics or physics or chemistry, you don't have all the different yisoids and all the different opinions what the din is. You have one mahalach that works all over the world. So we should teach them the accepted pshat in the Gemara. Okay, Rashi and Taisus have a machloket. We should emphasize whichever pshat is the one that's accepted halacha l'maaseh. We should emphasize that pshat. We have a lot of work to do in all the yeshivas. years ago, there were systems that were worked out in the 1700s and 1800s. There were systems in Chinuch that were worked out. And they wrote Svarim about this. Why shouldn't we look in their Svarim to pick up the tips that they recommend? How to be a successful in teaching Chumash or teaching Tanakh? The students don't even know the names of the prophets. You think that the Christian scholars are almost Avadim, so they heard them. They don't know the names of the Treyos, they don't know the names of the, they don't know the 24 Svarim of the Yisra Benish. This is scandalous. This is our Tanakh. Somehow we have fooled the students into believing that Limud Torah Shebe'etzah doesn't count. The Gemara says that we live in a generation where the emphasis has to be placed on the Torah Shebe'al Peh. The Gemara of Rabbi Basra says that the Eimis of the Golem, El Beskuz Limud Am Shnais. We live in a generation, the earlier generation's emphasis had to be on the Limud Torah Shebe'etzah, and in our generation, the emphasis has to be placed on the Limud Torah Shebe'al Peh. But they have to know that there is a Torah Shebe'etzah, they have to know what the names of the 24 Svarim are, they have to know who the Levim are, they have to know something about the Tanakh. The Gemara deals with the Psukim Tanakh. So a lot of times, the Gemara will quote an Agadah, the Gemara will quote a Pasuk from Tanakh. The students won't bother to look it up, the Rebbe won't bother to look it up. And the students get the mistaken impression as if the Gemara is quoting a phrase from the Pasuk out of context, has nothing to do with the rest of the chapter. It's not so. The Chazal had a tradition, a whole new interpretation of the whole chapter in Navi. If you look at the Malkin, or you look at the Avad Shemad, you look at the Svarim on Tanakh, they'll give you the whole shot. So you shouldn't just think that they took one line out of context. You have to collect all of the Midrashim to see how the Chazal, what was the tradition of the Chazal, how to have an additional level of interpretation in that puzzle. You have a lot of work to do. Okay, I think it's a wonderful idea that you have an all day long conference working on Chinuch. We have a lot to improve in the field of Chinuch. Should be with Hatzlachim.